Hello everyone, welcome to the Best of Bristol lecture series. To Best of Bristol lecture was started in 2012. Previously it was funded by an alumni foundation, but after that it gained so much widespread attention and support that now it is funded by Bristol Institute of Learning and Teaching, and it is an excellent example of student-led initiative and interdisciplinarity. It gives you an opportunity to discover lectures beyond your disciplinary boundaries. And yeah, so today we will have the pleasure to have a lecture from Walther Schwarzacher, who is well known for his dynamic, super interesting lectures in the School of Physics. Some of the comments from his students are, his lectures are never boring. He uses practical examples to prove that what we are studying is not a waste of time, making the lecture much more useful and entertaining at the same time. He makes physics fun, which, trust me, is not easy at all. So given such interesting comment, we wouldn't take much time in beginning his lecture. So now I would ask the professor to begin his interesting lecture on how does ice form.
Well, thank you very much. After a build-up like that, it can't do anything but get significantly worse. And the starting point is I have to walk over to the table to get my clicker. So the lecture officially starts now. And it starts with a question. The question is, at what temperature does ice melt? By the way, the reason why I put this picture up there is to put you in the mood. I wanted to show you some ice. In fact, I'm showing you rather a lot of ice there. This picture was taken out of the window of a plane when I was on my way to a conference, and it shows the edge of the Greenland ice cap. And it's not a good thing to go flying around, but if you have to go flying around, and it is bad for the environment, and we'll hear more about that later, then I think the very least that one can do is actually appreciate the view. Okay, so now you have had time to think about that question. At what temperature does ice melt? For the physicists here, this is not a trick question. The pressure should be just atmospheric pressure. And the answer is straightforward, 0 centigrade. Wow, that's exciting, isn't it? Here is another question. At what temperature does ice freeze? What is this guy after? He's already said that ice melts at 0 centigrade. Surely it has to freeze at 0 centigrade. Well, actually, no, not necessarily. And this really is going to be the theme of this lecture. The theme of this lecture is going to be the difference between the temperature at which ice melts and the temperature at which it freezes. So by the end of it, I hope you will understand why there's a difference and also why it actually is important and significant. So to show you that ice doesn't actually freeze at 0 centigrade, I'm going to take you on a short walk to our research lab. So this is the more impressive entrance to it in the so-called Nanoscience and Quantum Information building. We go up the steps, go through that door which is shown there, and then we turn round and look up at the wall. And this has got nothing to do with ice, but I just show it to you because it's rather neat. You can see here that there is various, whoops, there are various colored spots. You see little sticks sticking out there, blue sticks, red sticks, yellow sticks, and it's repeated up here. This is a cartoon version of a molecule, and it isn't any molecule. It is the molecule which, by some accounts, has contributed most to the progress of science. Those of you who don't know biology might say it's DNA. It's not DNA. It's a much more important molecule. It's actually the caffeine molecule. So, leaving that behind, we go to the lift, because today we're being lazy. After all, we are going in aeroplanes, which is very bad for the environment, so why not make it worse and go up in the lift? Go up in the lift and make our way to the entrance to the research lab. And when you go inside the research lab, this is what you will see. It's a very ordinary sort of lab, and the important thing is actually in this corner here. In fact, I've outlined it with this green circle. If you zoom in on that, then what you see is this. This is an experimental set of apparatus for looking at droplets of water freezing. You may ask yourself, why should anybody bother looking at droplets of water freeze? This is an everyday phenomenon. Surely everything that has to be known about that is known. Well, again, the answer is no, it isn't. So the details of this apparatus are that here you have the actual sample, which is held on a block, which is cooled. You can look at the sample with an optical microscope, and the actual cooling is done by using liquid nitrogen, which flows in and around the cooling block, and therefore cools, for example, a glass slide on which you put droplets of water. And the actual experiment gives you results which look like this. I'm going to show you a video at this point showing the droplets of water freeze. But the important thing to look at is this number in the top left-hand corner. You see that this is saying minus 20 degrees centigrade. This is minus 20 degrees centigrade, and none of those droplets is actually frozen. All of those are just water. So try and keep an eye on what goes on in the top left-hand corner at the same time as I set the video to run. Should work. Let's see, it's starting. Yes, okay, so it's gradually getting colder. And now finally at around minus 30 centigrade, you see these droplets becoming translucent. They become much more opaque. You can actually see that they have started to freeze. So the freezing is not taking place at zero centigrade. It's going down to about minus 30 centigrade before you actually see those droplets freeze. And the question is really, why should that be the case? But in order to explain it, we need to take a short pause. And here's something which is very important for it. And at this point, I would like to ask the organizers of the Bob Lectures to hand out the free demo for this lecture. Each of you should take an Oreo. Here is an Oreo. And hold it, and then when I tell you, then try to do the experiment. Basically, when you get your Oreo, look at it, take the aroma as if it is a fine wine. No, that's not actually part of the demonstration. Take your Oreo. The serious part is try to break it open. Try to actually pull apart the top part from the bottom part. Usually it will break, but hopefully you will also notice that you can't actually pull that biscuit apart without exerting a force. This is the key point. If you want to open up your Oreo, and when you open your Oreo, what you're actually doing is creating a fresh surface. So you see here where the white is. That was not exposed before. By pulling your Oreo apart, you are creating a fresh surface. And to create that fresh surface, you have to actually exert a force. What's more, you have to exert that force over a distance. And the physicists among you will know that exerting a force over a distance, product of force and distance, is work. So from a physical point of view, to create a fresh surface on an Oreo or on water or on anything else, you have to do work. And work requires energy. So basically, the reason behind giving you each an Oreo, apart from feeding you, because this is a slightly antisocial time at which to have a lecture. I saw some of you having your meal beforehand. I have not had my meal and am therefore quite hungry, and that might mean I speak a little bit more quickly than usual. It takes energy to create a surface. And this is important because this is relevant to why ice actually freezes at a temperature lower than zero centigrade. So consider a spherical ice crystal of radius r. Real ice crystals are not necessarily spherical, but this is actually not a bad approximation for the very first stage of formation of an ice crystal. And this process of forming the very first ice crystal within water is called nucleation, because all of the ice that grows around that spherical ice crystal or nucleus, you can see that in some sense that initial ice crystal is the nucleus of all the ice that forms afterwards. So we consider our spherical ice crystal, and we consider the fact that there is a surface, or strictly speaking, an interface between the ice and the water. That interface is a surface. So creating that surface, just as creating the surface in the Oreo requires energy, creating the surface between the ice and the water requires energy. And the amount of energy that it costs to create that surface is proportional to the area. That's not the only energy which is important. In addition to costing energy to form ice, you actually also save energy, because ice at low temperatures is a lower energy form of water. So the saving in energy is proportional to the volume. So you see that to create an ice crystal, you're balancing two energy terms. You're balancing the surface energy cost and the interior energy saving. You should be aware from everyday experience that energy is saved when you go from a liquid to a solid, because if you go from a liquid to a solid or freeze it, then heat is released. So every time that you go from a liquid to a solid, heat is released. And that heat is that same bulk energy saving which I've referred to. And it's given the name, the latent heat of fusion. Fusion is just melting. So you can show this diagrammatically. If you start with a liquid and go to a solid, then heat is released. And for that too, I can do a simple demonstration. I have got more samples of this material so that those of you who would like to afterwards can come and experience it live. But basically, this is a liquid. I mean, you can see that I'm squishing it around. This is a liquid. I can find out what temperature it is using this rather advanced remote thermometer. If I take the liquid and press my thermometer and aim at it, it comes up with a temperature of about 22 centigrade. It's not surprising. You would expect that the temperature of this room would be around 20 centigrade, give or take a few degrees. Fine. That's the liquid. Inside here, there is a little metal plate. If I squeeze this metal plate, then I will create an initial solid, and that solid will then spread through the whole liquid, and it will solidify. So let's see if this works, if I can bend this. Yes, now you can see the solid spreading through it, I hope. You see it's sort of spreading from this corner, and it's gradually going out, and now it's no longer quite so flexible as it was. It has solidified. But the interesting thing is what happens to the temperature. Because now if I take the same thermometer and I hold this against it, it's now come out as 53 centigrade. So that's significantly warmer. And if you really think about it, this is an example of the same phenomenon. Because if this goes up to 53 centigrade, it's actually going up to the melting temperature. It means that this material actually melts at 53 centigrade. So why does it go down to room temperature or 22 degrees centigrade and still remain a liquid? It's again exactly the same phenomenon, that you need to create a surface between the solid and the liquid in order to create the solid phase. And when you do create the solid phase, then heat is given out. So just as water can exist well below its melting point, so too this material can exist as a liquid well below its normal melting point. So this is an example at a temperature well above 0 Celsius of exactly the same phenomenon. We have a freezing point and a melting point which are different. And that actually is the reason for the somewhat punning subtitle of this talk. How does ice form? It's cooler than you think, because ice actually forms at a much lower temperature than you might really think, because it certainly forms below the melting point. So that is the release of energy when you go from a liquid to a solid. And that energy that's released is called the latent heat of fusion. So what that means is we get back to the spherical ice crystal. And we have an energy cost, which is proportional to area, and an energy saving, which is proportional to volume. And here we can bring in a little bit of mathematics. Yay. Don't be afraid of it if you are not physicists, scientists, mathematicians, or anything else like that. That's a very, very simple formula. The area is proportional to the radius squared. Okay, most people remember that the area of a circle is pi r squared. The volume is proportional to the radius cubed. Fairly simple. And the interesting point is that there is a balance between them. The surface cost, which is proportional to r squared, is positive. So that's the cost. The saving is negative. You can see the minus sign there. And it's proportional to r cubed. So which one of those two terms is going to dominate? Well, let's think of a simple example of r. Let's say that r is equal to 1/10. If r is equal to 1/10, r squared is 1/100th. R cubed is 1/1000th. Which of those is the bigger number? 1/100th is definitely bigger than 1/1000th. So that means that, in fact, the surface cost is going to dominate. If you go to a bigger number, let's take 2 as an example. Square 2 and you get 4. Cube it and you get 8. Now the cubic term is dominating. So if you put all of that together and look at how the total energy cost depends on the radius, it's a really very simple curve. Initially it increases, and in fact the shape of this curve is a parabola because it's dominated by the r squared term. And then eventually the volume term kicks in and it starts to come down again. And there is a maximum which is a barrier. Somehow the system has to, as the radius increases, it somehow has to get up over that energy barrier. So remember that the increase here is due to the squared term, which is the surface energy cost, and the decrease is due to the energy saving, the energy released when you go from a liquid to a solid, which is the latent heat of fusion, which I demonstrated with this example. That energy barrier really is analogous just to an ordinary hill. So here is an example of an energy barrier which will be probably familiar to anybody who is living in Orchard Heights. Park Street. If you want to get up to attend your exciting physics lectures, then you have to overcome the energy barrier and go from the bottom of Park Street to the top of it. And this really is an energy barrier that's exactly analogous to the one that I'm showing you on that graph. Here, you have to increase your gravitational energy because the reason it's hard to walk up a hill is because you're doing work against gravity. Here, you're doing work to create a surface between the liquid and the solid phase. So, one thing which I should point out is that there is a critical radius. The critical nucleus, that value of the radius is the value of the radius beyond which the nucleus grows spontaneously. Again, you can see that really. It makes sense. As you increase the radius, the energy of the system increases, increases, increases. But once you get up to the top of the energy barrier, if the system gets any larger, the energy will start to decrease. Anything which leads to a decrease in energy happens spontaneously, so then the ice crystal grows. So as soon as you get an ice crystal of this critical size, then it can grow and the whole of the material will freeze. And that's what we saw here. I created a nucleus actually by bending a piece of metal in the corner of this gel pack, and from it spread out the solid phase. Okay, so let's take this a little bit further. Those of you who are thinking seriously about what I'm saying might wonder if it actually costs energy to form that first ice crystal, how come it actually is more likely that water will freeze as you go to lower and lower temperatures? Because as you go to lower and lower temperatures, there's less and less energy available. Well, the reason is, again, going to this formula for the total cost. Because as the temperature decreases, the amount of energy saved by going from the liquid water to the solid ice increases. In other words, this value y increases, therefore the negative component increases, and therefore your barrier gets smaller. So actually, the world does make sense. Even in this simple picture, the lower the temperature you go, the more likely you are to have ice. Okay. Now we start to... Most of what I've talked about so far is reasonably well understood, at least at a macroscopic level. Now we get on to the interesting part, which is, how can I lower that barrier? Can I lower it any other way than just by going to lower and lower temperatures? And the answer to that is actually, yes, we can. And it's quite a trick that you have to pull off. You have to keep the radius of your critical nucleus the same, while at the same time reducing the volume. So how do you take a sphere, reduce its volume, while keeping its radius the same? Well, the answer is, as I phrase it there, you can't. But what you can do is you can cheat a little bit. You form your nucleus, your first stage of ice, on a surface. So, as shown schematically here. Because if I go from a sphere to a hemisphere, I am halving the energy of the system. There are a few subtleties in that, but let's say I'm halving the energy of the system, but I'm keeping the radius the same. And it's this curvature which really comes into the expression for the energy barrier. And when you do this, as to whether you can do this or not, and whether it is a hemisphere or a smaller segment of a sphere, what is absolutely important is the energy of the interface. Now, not the interface between the solid ice and liquid water, but the interface between the solid and the ice. That which I have shaded in purple, the difference in energy between that interface with the liquid and that interface with the ice, determines whether you can have a nucleus forming on a surface. And as I flipped over quite quickly, the process of forming a nucleus on another material is called heterogeneous nucleation. Heterogeneous because it is nucleation on a different phase to what you are just working with. So if you have nucleation of water turning spontaneously into ice, that is homogeneous nucleation. If you need another material, it's called heterogeneous nucleation. And heterogeneous nucleation, although it is really important, and I will try to convince you of that, it is very, very, very poorly understood, particularly at an atomic level. So it's this interface energy which is the key to whether you can get heterogeneous nucleation take place. By the way, to some extent, you can relax after this. All the quantitative parts has been finished. After this, it's mostly qualitative. You've done the hard bit, now you can relax and enjoy the entertainment, or go to sleep, whatever you choose. So here I will show you a video showing that if you have got surfaces, in this case the surface is actually just dust, inside your droplets, then the temperature at which the water freezes is significantly higher. So this is a very similar video to the one you have before. Just keep an eye on the temperature in that top left-hand corner. The starting temperature already is significantly higher than it was before. Remember, in the previous video, it was minus 20 centigrade. Here it's minus 10 centigrade. So let's see if I can start this video. Okay, so it's gradually going down in temperature. And already it's about minus 16, 18. By minus 20, which is where the previous video actually started, almost all of the ice has formed. So there's a big difference between those two videos. In both cases, we had water droplets. The only difference is that we effectively sprinkled a little bit of dust, and it's quite special dust, and I will say more about that later, into the water, and that made it freeze at a much warmer temperature. So how can I manipulate that energy between ice and a surface? What will favour forming ice on a surface? Well, really, there are two things. One of them is to have a strong chemical interaction between the surface and ice. The second one is to have a surface with an atomic structure that matches that of ice. Because if you have a strong chemical interaction between the surface and the ice, then you have got a system which is quite stable. And the same is true if you have got a surface with an atomic structure that matches that of ice, you find that it is easy to form the ice on the surface, and therefore the energy barrier is small. So if you do have a match in structure between the ice and the material you grow on it, you can get oriented ice crystals. So all of the ice crystals will end up looking, pointing in the same direction. And you can see this in this experimental data, which is from a paper which was published in a very good journal this year. And what you can see there are ice crystals. These ice crystals have not been grown from a liquid, they've actually been grown from the vapor. But what you can see is these little things that look like, well, they look a bit like, from this angle, like Monopoly houses. And there you see more cubes growing from the surface. But you can see that all of them have the same orientation. Now, this is really only going to happen if there's something that makes that happen. And what makes that happen is actually a match between the crystal structure of the surface and the crystal structure of ice. So I've given you an introduction to heterogeneous ice nucleation, this forming of ice on the surface. So why am I wasting your time with this? Why have I brought you along here to learn all about ice nucleation? Or to put it another way, why should heterogeneous nucleation be important? Well, let's go for the big stuff straight off. Climate change. Heterogeneous nucleation. Why would that affect climate change? Well, the reason is that clouds also contain water which is well below its freezing point. So-called mixed phase clouds, which are the ones at heights up to a few kilometres, contain substantial amounts of water, down to temperatures of minus 37.5 centigrades, maybe in some cases below. So here you see a thunderstorm cloud. This cloud was again taken out of an aeroplane window. It is coming in, this was when coming into land in Siberia, so one gets to some quite exotic locations when you're doing research. I'm very proud of this photograph because of this little orange hole here. Because you can see the sort of sunrise in the background, you might think that that orange light is actually just the sun shining through. It's not. I actually, by continually pressing on my phone, I actually managed to catch the moment at which the lightning was going. So that's actually the lightning from the thundercloud in the middle of it. So that's really just an introduction to clouds. Clouds are going to be pretty obviously important to climate change. Well, is it really that obvious? Greenhouse effect. One of the things which is responsible for the possibility of the Earth warming up. The idea behind the greenhouse effect is that the sun sends radiation through the atmosphere towards the Earth. It's absorbed by the Earth, heating it up. And when the Earth heats up, it also gives off radiation. But that radiation is a bit different from the radiation which comes in. You can think of that in a crude way as saying that the radiation which comes in is mostly light, the radiation which comes out is mostly heat. Infrared radiation, heat radiation, has a longer wavelength. That's one of its physical properties. But it doesn't actually matter really what that means, except to say that whether light is reflected or transmitted by any material depends very much on its wavelength. So the reason for the greenhouse effect is that you have radiation coming in, which is visible light and radiation which comes out that is heat, and the interaction of the incoming radiation with the atmosphere and the radiated radiation from the Earth is going to be different. So what actually happens is that as the heat radiation goes up through the atmosphere, some of it is reflected, or in many cases strictly absorbed and re-radiated. So what that actually has as its effect is that the amount of heat which is lost from the Earth is reduced, and that makes it more likely that the Earth will gradually warm. It's a question of balancing a budget. It's the budget of the amount of radiation and energy that comes in and the amount of radiation and energy that goes out again. And the reason why clouds are important is that they perturb this energy balance. So here you see a schematic of a cloud, and the cloud can radiate, can reflect some of the radiation which comes in from the sun. That's a good thing, it cools the Earth, but it can also reflect some of the radiation that comes up from the Earth. That's a bad thing, that means that the Earth warms up. So you can see that what happens with a cloud, because it affects the radiation which comes from the sun and it affects the radiation which comes from the Earth, is going to affect the balance of energy coming in and going out, and therefore can contribute to the warming or otherwise of our planet. And why heterogeneous nucleation is important is because the reflectivity of a cloud, its optical properties, depends on whether it's composed of water droplets or ice crystals. You might say that it only depends on the temperature of the cloud. Well, no, because I've just shown you that whether you have got water droplets or ice crystals depends also on whether you've got heterogeneous nucleation taking place. Now, not only whether you have water droplets or ice crystals is important, but also the size of those ice crystals. I can give you an example. Cirrus clouds, which form at maybe 6 kilometres and above the Earth, they're the very wispy clouds that you see on a fine day, for example. Cirrus clouds are actually quite bad because they let the short wavelength light, the visible light, through, and are very good at reflecting thermal radiation because of the size of the ice crystals in it. So cirrus clouds are actually bad. And this is a problem for those of us who go in aeroplanes, because whenever you see an aeroplane going, you see a vapor trail coming behind it. And that vapor trail, you might think, ah, I'm doing something great for the environment because it's going to reflect sunlight. Unfortunately, I wish that were the case, but I don't think it is. I think what happens is that it's also having a bad effect because it does not reflect very much of the sun coming in and reflects a lot of the thermal radiation coming out from the Earth. So heterogeneous nucleation is really important because it determines for a given temperature whether you have got ice in your cloud or water, and hence what the optical properties and the environmental effect of the clouds is. So how can you get nucleating agents, things which will cause ice to form at higher temperatures, into the atmosphere? One very good example is mineral dust. So this is the last of my photographs out of aircraft windows. This is showing the sun setting above Dubai Airport. And you can see that it's a rather nice sunset. It is very, very hazy and orange. And the reason for that is the amount of mineral dust in the atmosphere. So mineral dust from desert can actually have a big effect on the nature of the water in clouds, because it can make a difference as to whether that water freezes or remains as water. And it turns out that some minerals are exceptionally good at nucleating ice. This is experimental data from, again, a relatively recent experiment. Don't really worry about the details. Just notice that there is a temperature shown on the bottom line, and there are various coloured lines. And as you move from left to right, you're moving to higher and higher temperatures. Each one of these colours refers to a different mineral. You can see that these green circles appear at higher temperatures than all of the other ones. What that's telling you is that they cause nucleation, the transformation of water to ice at higher temperatures. And they all correspond to a mineral which is called potassium feldspar. So potassium feldspar turns out to be an extremely good ice nucleating agent. And in fact, the video which I showed you had that very special dust, potassium feldspar, added to the water droplets. As well as mineral dust, there are other natural sources, such as, for example, pollutants, biological materials, which I'll say more about later, and volcanic ash. So this was data from an undergraduate project, which was subsequently published, showing the efficiency of ice nucleation by volcanic dust. And you might think that's not so relevant to the environment because volcanoes don't erupt that often. Well, actually, they do erupt quite often. And what happens with ice nucleation by volcanic dust is relevant not only to climate change, but also to transport, because I think most of you will remember that I think it was 2010 that Icelandic volcano erupted, and that stopped people flying around for a bit. And one of the things which is difficult when a volcanic eruption takes place is to predict where an ash cloud is going to go to. And the transport of ash through the environment, through the atmosphere, will depend on whether that ash is coated by ice or not. So studying whether volcanic ash can nucleate ice is important for being able to predict the distribution of ash after a volcanic eruption, which is very important in being able to predict where it's safe for aircraft to fly. So I said that biological materials can nucleate ice. And one example is this particular plant pathogen. It's a pathogen because it creates this disease on a tomato leaf. It actually, part of the efficiency of this bacterium, this pathogen, comes about because it produces a natural ice nucleating agent. And that means that ice forms at a much higher temperature than it would otherwise, and the ice actually damages the surface of the leaf, which makes it possible for the bacterium to extract nutrition. So in this case, having a natural nucleating agent helps the bacterium to attack the material that it grows off. Sometimes it actually turns out that ice nucleation is an advantage. This is a really neat example. There is a particular kind of lobelia which grows on Mount Kenya in Africa, which does something, if one were to anthropomorphize it, is extremely intelligent. What it has is it has water trapped in it, and that water contains a really efficient ice nucleating agent. And what happens is that every day the mountain surface is relatively warm, at night it gets cold, and so the plant is in danger of freezing, which would damage it. What actually happens is that instead of the plant freezing, the water which is trapped in a place where it cannot do any damage freezes. And because when water freezes, it releases heat, it actually stops the temperature going any lower and therefore damaging the plant. And you can see this if you actually look at the temperature of the plant as a function of time. So you see, this is just showing the temperature as a function of the time going through the day. So what happens is as you get to nighttime, the dotted line represents the outside temperature. So the outside temperature at night falls rapidly, and then it starts to rise again when the sun comes up. And so what you can see is that the temperature falls and then starts to rise. Here is the temperature not of the outside environment, but the temperature of the plant. And the temperature of the plant plateaus, stays close to 0 degrees centigrade because ice nucleates. And that ice forming, like this example I gave you here, is actually releasing heat. So now to the question, for those of you who actually bothered to read my blurb before coming here, where do fish come in? I've talked about volcanic dust, I've talked about ice nucleation, but what about fish? Where they come in is antifreeze proteins. And antifreeze proteins, a lot of the physics of antifreeze proteins is very similar to the physics of ice nucleation. What an antifreeze protein is, the name sort of gives it away. It is something which is found in organisms that live in cold temperatures and basically stops them freezing. And the way that this works is they work by the same sort of thing that is important in heterogeneous nucleation. In heterogeneous nucleation, you want to have something which binds very strongly to ice because that lowers the energy barrier. But if you have the right material that binds strongly to ice and then stops more ice forming on top of it, then that actually can stop an ice crystal growing. So that's how an antifreeze protein works. It binds strongly to ice, but slows the ice crystal growth. And here you can actually see the structure of ice as predicted by a calculation above the protein. And you can see that, again, we have this, the protein does actually match quite well the structure of the protein does match quite well the structure of the ice. So this is this other thing I was saying. It's not only the strength of the interaction between the material you want to grow your ice on and the ice that's important, but also a match of the structure. And in fact, antifreeze protein apparently finds application in ice cream. So Unilever, at least according to the internet, has found a way to take the antifreeze protein, the particular antifreeze protein which is found in this fish, which is called an ocean pout. They took the structure of that antifreeze protein, then they grow something very similar to that protein in yeast. That's a way of producing large quantities of the protein, because if you wanted to produce the protein by mashing up fish, then it would be environmentally rather unsound and would be also quite expensive. So they take this protein, which is produced from yeast, mix it into ice cream. And the reason why that is good is it means that your ice cream can be kept for much longer. Because if you have ice cream in a freezer and you leave it and leave it and leave it, what happens is that the ice crystals in it grow. And as the ice crystals in ice cream grow, it becomes quite unpleasant. It becomes sort of jagged and it loses its creaminess. Ice cream is only creamy providing the ice crystals don't get too big. And so if you put this fish protein into ice cream, it actually stops the ice crystals growing and means that ice cream stays nice and smooth and creamy for longer. Actually, we do our own research on ice cream, but I'm not going to give you a sample of it because, one, it doesn't look very appetizing. And the reason for that is that we study the interactions of particles with ice by mixing in lots of magnetic nanoparticles, very small particles, into the ice. Of course, the other reason is that our recipe involves 1 gram of icing sugar and 5 milliliters of double cream, and that doesn't really produce enough ice cream to give round to you. So that's the reason why you have Oreos rather than a sample of ice cream. And that actually brings me to the end of this lecture. You can read the summary here, and if any of you have got any questions, please feel free to ask them. Any questions?
What does the metal do in the handle that triggers nucleation?
That is a very good question to which I don't know the exact answer. So this is one of those things about nucleation that I, for one, don't really understand. Whether it is, I won't claim that I know the answer to that. But we can discuss it tomorrow since you're doing a PhD with me.
Does the antifreeze protein in fish like affect the ice kind of nucleation by like hydrogen bonding from the amino acids?
The way that it works is that ice forms, it nucleates, but as soon as you get a small ice crystal, this protein sticks around it. The protein has got two sides, essentially. It's got an ice-binding side and a non-ice-binding side. So what happens is that half of it sticks to the ice and coats the ice and leaves behind a surface which it would be very difficult for more ice to grow on. So it basically sort of covers the ice over and stops it growing.
Fish live somewhere very cold, or has it got a different reason for needing that protein?
Again, I don't know. I'd have to check that on the standard source, which would be Wikipedia. I suspect that the answer is yes, but that's only suspecting. But these things are found in plants, they're found in animals, they're found in, and not only fish, but insects, all sorts of different things. And there are a huge variety of different structures, and the ways in which they work can be quite different.
With the cirrus clouds, is there a possibility to release some of these dust particles on aeroplane engines to reduce the formation of them? Is that something you're looking into?
The trouble is that, well, geoengineering is one of the interesting possibilities. So if you were to reduce lots of dust particles, then perhaps you could then have many more small ice crystals, which would have different properties. They might actually be better than the cirrus clouds as formed naturally. But again, don't take what I say as gospel. I always tell my undergraduate tutees that the advantage of being an academic as distinct from working in a high school is I'm allowed to get things wrong. Teachers are not.
It's like we know that the protein exists there in the fish, but how it developed, how it appear there in the organism of the fish? What is the mechanism that created this protein there?
The mechanism for creating the protein presumably is the same as creating any other protein. The template for it exists in the DNA inside each individual cell of the fish. And this, of course, is how they are able to produce this protein using yeast, because what you do is you then engineer the DNA of the yeast so that it produces the same protein. How it evolved in the first place, that's another question. But again, you can see it gives an advantage if you're living in a cold climate.
Is this phenomenon is observed in only water, or it can be observed in like some kind of liquid without like polar, non-polar, or without hydrogen bonding?
It can be involved in, it does not have to be involved in water. It can be involved in other systems, because the reason behind it is very general. It's the fact that it requires energy to create a surface. And if you think about it, if you go from one phase, the liquid, to the solid, you always have an interface between the two, and that costs energy, so there is a problem with nucleation. The exact detail of what will encourage nucleation, of course, will depend on the liquid. Another thing which is quite interesting about these biological nucleating agents is, I showed you that plant pathogen. I believe that the ice nucleating agent from that is the basis of snowmax, which is an artificial snow generating material. So if you have artificial snow, the reason you can do that comparatively inexpensively is because of natural heterogeneous nucleating agents.
You showed work on naturally occurring ice nucleating particles. Are there anything that's man-made or superficial in that sense?
Yes. I'm just writing a grant application to be allowed to make these. So if the government gives me the money to do it, the answer to that question will be yes.
I'm just thinking, so you're looking for ways of making them. What for, I suppose, for the obvious question, or is that something you need to keep quiet?
There are lots of different answers to that. One of them is that if you can actually make nucleating agents, you can separate the different things which could influence what makes a good ice nucleating agent and a bad one. So you can separate the effects of chemical order, structural order, even geometry. Because if you think about the energies involved, if you've got a wedge-shaped crack, then ice nucleation should be faster than that. So if you can actually engineer your particles, you can actually separate out these different influences, and you can then actually begin to understand heterogeneous nucleation, because the understanding of this is at a very poor level. And if you can understand heterogeneous nucleation, then you can predict which dusts, which other materials are going to be effective ice nucleators or not. And this is one of the major causes of uncertainty in climate models, is that this link between dust and optical properties of clouds really is not known. So trying to understand nucleation is one key thing. Nucleating agents can also be important in things like cryobiology, because if you are going to freeze tissue, what you do not want is very large ice crystals forming, because those very large ice crystals will damage the tissue. If you have lots and lots of very, very small ice crystals, that's not such a problem. So it's useful for that as well. And it's fun. No, there was one more question. Sorry.
I got a rather fundamental question. How do you separate the heterogeneous nucleation from homogeneous nucleation, since all surfaces are fundamentally an heterogeneous place for nucleation?
Yes, well, for example, the way you can do it is by, one way of doing it would be by having a droplet which is levitated and therefore has got no surface which is pressing against it, and that's actually what Fred's PhD project is to do. So you can actually purify things and you can get rid of it. And of course the other obvious thing is if you deliberately add some sort of material to your water and find that it is nucleating at a higher temperature, then that's fairly easy to say is going to be heterogeneous nucleation. So you can reduce the influence of any surface, but yes, you can't have water which doesn't have, say, even the droplet, you've got the interface with air. But again, what you can do, if you think about the statistics of it, is that if you look at droplets of different size, the ratio of surface to volume is different, and so you can actually separate out surface effects and volume effects.
Thank you.
Welcome. Okay, I think, yay, I get a second one. Right, thank you.